it is all self-explanatory. And what isn't, you know, what you don't understand, don't hang in with it. Just keep going. Because basically, this is the first draft. I'm only going to read the beginning, obviously. I'm not going to read the 300 pages. It would really be just the next two. So proud because my deadline was July 1st to get my first draft in. And July 1st. That's, oh, was that Canada Day? Well, how appropriate. July 1st, the disc went right into the, you know, so I was very happy about that. Those of you who have heard this before, you're going to hear new stuff. Those of you who just say, like, heard the last reason, because every time it gets changed, because I'm constantly. And it's at situations like this where I'll be reading and I'll hear something and I'm thinking, oh man, that's, you know, cool. Yeah, no, that's not right. So I have to restrain myself from doing that in the middle of reading here. So, anyway, A Stitch in Time, Memoirs of the Cardassian Two, Prologue. My dear doctor, forgive my delay in responding to your kind. I wanted to give this modest chronicle I've enclosed some modicum of organization before I sent it on to you. Thank you for your concern. I've thought of you often since our last meeting, and I'm pleased to hear that your life on Deep Space Nine remains challenging and productive. Considering all the changes that have taken place, I would have expected nothing less. And I'm certainly not surprised that your research proposals have been accepted. You're a brilliant young scientist. Even if you are genetically enhanced. As for my life here, it's the dust. Oh, I can live with the rubble. I can live with the survivors who move like holographic phantoms and spend every waking hour scavenging for whatever would keep them alive. I can even live with the stench of the corpses that litter the broken streets, waiting in grotesque poses, waiting to be transported to mass graves. But it's the dust that suffocates me and challenges my sanity. It clogs my nose, blurs my sight. My mouth is filled with a chalky paste that food and drink, scarce commodities, only thicken. We exist in a penumbral world where every shape and sound is blurred and muffled by this restless cloud of dust that refuses to settle and chokes my every breath. Yes, Doctor, I have returned home. The only house I've ever known has been reduced to rubble. Fortunately, the little outbuilding in the back where Tolan stored his landscaping implements is still standing, and I've been able to clear a path to it and make a small place for myself inside. Indeed, as I'm writing this, I'm sitting here with the door open to make it feel larger. It's an ironic view I demand. The dust and rubble of the home of Inabrin Tain, the man who attempted to destroy the founder's home world. The founders had indeed exacted a Cardassian justice. And then there's the added irony of my own homecoming, Doctor, and finding nothing but Tolan's tools and shed. An irony I think you will fully appreciate when you finish reading this recollection. Yes, I'm afraid you weren't expecting this response to your kind inquiry. It goes a bit farther than greetings from Cardassia. It seems I'm arrogant enough to believe that not only is this collection of reminiscences not an imposition, but something that might actually interest you. I began writing this last year when Captain Sisko invited me to join the initial invasion of Cardassia, an event I wasn't sure I'd survive. My fondest wish at that time, as you well know, was to free my homeland from Dominion tyranny, and here I am, a survivor in a liberated Cardassia. but a Cardassia haunted by the souls of countless millions slaughtered, who the form of this dust cloud that constantly swirls and shrieks across this wasteland, vainly searching for a peaceful place to rest. It's almost as if my homecoming has come at their expense. Part 1, Chapter 1. To Dr. Julian Bashir, Chief Medical Officer of Space 9, entry. How odd you humans are. Or is it just the start? Captain Sisko has just invited me to join the invasion of Cardassia, for which I am eternally grateful. The opportunity to liberate my homeland renews and animates my sluggish spirit. But the good captain makes no mention of the fact that this invasion is now possible because of the incident with the Romulans. I'm simply to report to his office at $0900 with ideas as to where the Dominion defense perimeter might be vulnerable. Oh, our dealings with each other are nothing less than proper. Mr. Garrett, Captain Sisko. But what's so odd is that he pretends the incident never happened, and you and I both know how deeply affected he was by the whole business. Only when we exchange direct looks do I perceive a flicker of what? Anger? Betrayal? Violation? Humans walk through life's infinite variety of relationships and situations and take it all at face value. They rarely look behind the facade or the mask where the real intentions, the truth of our motives live. And the fact is, more often than not, they deny that they have any mask at all. These humans, and I do exclude you, Doctor, which I will come to shortly, believe that what they present to the world, and conversely, what the world presents to them, is the truth. It's this belief that makes them dangerous. See, in Cardassian society, we are taught from an early age to mask all thoughts and feelings, to deflect all outside perception and observation. The objective of this education is to create a citizen who can work within the group to accomplish a group goal established by the leader, and at the same time, work in such a way that none of the other members of the group knows what he or she is doing. As long as the goal is accomplished, it's nobody's business how you went about your work. So why Captain Sisko is so upset with me because I accomplished the goal which he established. Of getting Romulus into the war against the Dominion. That is wrong. And it's not because of the few lives that were sacrificed. Dominion, well, Federation expansion has taken the toll of countless life forms, most of which they are blissfully unaware. The moment you step into a garden and begin to cultivate and prune, you become a killer. Perhaps the captain was upset because he hesitated to do what was necessary to ensure the integrity of his garden. Sentimentality is the other trait that makes humans dangerous. But why am I writing this to you instead of waxing philosophically over one of our lunches? I can see that polite, overly polite smile. You're get to the point, Garrick. Patience, dear doctor. First, let me explain why I exempt you from this human bondage to appearance and sentiment. As much as the subject irritates you, you've not been so much genetically enhanced as arranged. The people who did this to you had specific reasons which you have long since outlived. Subsequently, you have accommodated yourself to this arrangement according to the demands of your life. For me, this means that, in a sense, you are more Cardassian than human, which is why I am able to share this document with you, and why I sat down to lunch with you in the first place. Now, before you cringe in horror at the thought of being a Cardassian, let me give you an example. Human memory is selective and linear. Simply put, a human remembers the best of times in progressive order, beginning with earliest childhood. The rosy memories are only challenged by nightmares. A Cardassian remembers everything on every level all the time. For us, past and present are not really separated. We live with everything in the moment, including the nightmare. And so do you. Now, to a normal human, this would be chaotic, intolerable. For us, it's just the way it is. This is one reason why I'm addressing this revelation. Fate lines are converging, like memories to a dying man. I need to write this, Doctor. And you're the only person in this station who understands. The invasion of Cardassia is momentous. Many will die. If I don't survive, I want you to deliver copies of this to some people I will name at the end. Now, there's another reason. I know that we have grown apart, and that's as it should be. We learn what we can from certain people, and then we move on after we've taken what we need. When we learn nothing new about ourselves in a relationship, that's when the relationship is over. Or it's over the moment when we're afraid to learn something new about ourselves. But what I've been learning about myself, whatever it was that was sparked and challenged when I first met you, this is still going on and deeply connected to this story. I'm an unfinished man, Doctor. Like a suit of clothes hanging on a display rack, waiting for the final touches that may never come. I need to tell the story to make peace with those parts of me that were left unfinished. A healing. Indulge me, if you will. I need you as a witness. Stitch in time. Chapter 2. Andrew. When I was at the age of emergence, I was sent to the Bamaran Institute for State Intelligence to begin my education as a security operative. This kind of education was usually reserved for children of the current ruling elite, but sometimes a child from the service ranks is identified as promising. I was one of those children. My father was a maintenance work foreman in charge of the grounds, monuments, and memorials of the Tarlac Sector, a majestic and ghostly place that commemorates the heroes of the Cardassian state. My mother was a housekeeper of Inabrin Teng, the man who owned the house we lived in and who worked at the Obsidian Order, the mysterious agency responsible for state security. We lived in the basement apartment of Uncle Inabrin's house, and my parents proudly identified themselves as servants of Cardassian public ritual and cleanliness. It was always assumed that I would become apprentice to my father. Many of my earliest memories are about preparing for and cleaning up after state funerals and dedication ceremonies. I was a serious little boy, assiduously carrying out my duties and responsibilities. I had to. My father was much older than mother, and he never said much, but what he did say was always clear and to the point. Anyone who worked with him understood that if he had to repeat himself, he would be very quickly demoted to maintaining the city's service. My mother not only maintained Tane's house, but she also worked with him at the Obsidian Order. He was particular about who cooked and cleaned for him and depended upon mother for all his personal needs. I was never sure what it was he did. I just assumed he was important enough to afford a house and a servant. The Obsidian Order in those days was housed underneath the assembly building, and it was years before I even knew where the entrance was. As a child, I would go to the Tarlac Sector with father, and while he supervised the crews, I'd play by myself among the black and white angularity of the monuments, imagining myself to be a great gull or a legate giving the funeral oration for a fallen comrade. There was nothing, however, about the Obsidian Order that inspired or excited my childish fantasies. Nothing but silence and mystery. But Tane, at home, was anything but mysterious. It was not unusual for Uncle Inaban to appear and take me away on some excursion that involved a long walk through a section of the city. And during these walks, he'd test my awareness and challenge me to describe a house or a person we just passed. I could look. If I hadn't been paying attention and couldn't remember the details, the walk was over and would silently return home under the weight of his oppressive disapproval. He also seemed to know how I was performing at school, and if he didn't approve of my progress or behavior, he'd punish me. I was a hard worker, but I had a mischievous streak, and I enjoyed getting others involved in questionable activities and arranging it so that they found out, and that they were found out and took the blame. On those rare occasions when I was caught, Tane would somehow find out and punish me, not for my misdeed, but for having been caught. And when he discovered my fear of small, dark spaces, his favorite punishment was to keep me in one until I convinced him that I had analyzed and fully understood how my mischievous scheme had gone wrong. I found it odd that mother and father never had anything to say about his punishment. One day, shortly after my emergent ceremony at school, where I was acknowledged as a man, I came home ready to assist father at the dedication of the Voltaire War Memorial. I was surprised to find my parents at home with a stranger. They were never at home at this time of day, and we rarely entertained guests. They were very private people, and even discouraged me from bringing any of my schoolmates home. Both were clearly ill at ease with this man, who was introduced to me as an official from Placement Institute. At first I thought I was in trouble, and my face must have reflected this fear, because father attempted to reassure me with a forced smile. But the uncharacteristic falsity of his behavior, his barely concealed agitation, only made the situation worse. I'd never seen him like this. Mother's face was a mask. It revealed nothing. She spoke as if I needed to clean off the day's work before we ate. Ela, it seems you have a sponsor. You're going to be placed at a prestigious institute you lead today. Just like that. Any kind of response was beyond me. I had no idea who this meant. I stood there, looking at the three of them, looking at me, and expecting some kind of reaction on my part. At the Maran Institute, father added, as if this was the Bible of the missing piece that would enlighten me. Oh, I knew about the institutes and what student didn't. I knew that each student needed a sponsor, someone high up in the government or military who would recommend the student and guarantee his or her performance. And I knew that I had reached the age when students were moved on to their next educational level, the level that determined their working lives. But those schoolmates of mine who were identified and assigned to an institute knew well in advance that they were going, and they knew who the sponsor was. When I began to ask who mine was, father cut me off. That's not your business, Ela. Your business is to get clean and ready to go. His business is to serve Cardassia and the Empire in thought, word, and deed, in tone to the official. Your childhood is over, Ela. I was stunned. I wanted to ask more. I wanted to ask about the dedication ceremony that afternoon. Father had that look on one of the papers, didn't get it right the first time. But what had I done wrong? Mother, as if reading my mind, suddenly turned to me. This is a great honor, Elam. She said, a passion that startled me and belied her mask. I thought it was anything but. Oh, it was a long time before I learned the truth from my sponsor. Chapter 3. You will be pleased to hear, Doctor, that I volunteered to work with an emergency med unit in the city. Whenever people are found alive in the ruins, we are called in to administer aid and to make sure that they can be moved to a medical facility. It's miraculous how some have survived for days, even weeks, buried under the tons of collapsed buildings. Just yesterday, searchers detected life signs in the middle of rubble at least four stories high. When we managed to reach the survivors, we found a dead mother with her baby who was still clinging to life. Dr. Parnak, the unit leader, worked furiously destabilized the little girl, and when she was evacuated by the transport unit, he broke down. He's a very good man, this Dr. Carmack. He reminds me of an older version of yourself, Doctor. But what is, again, ironic is that Dr. Carmack was once marginally involved in an illegal, in an illegal political group, and when he was arrested, yes, he was responsible for his interrogation. Now, the man was anything but a coward, but his sensitivity is such that all I had to do was stare at him for 4 hours, and he told us everything he knew. He claims that even today he has a hard time looking me in the eyes. I asked his forgiveness, and he was kind enough to give it. I hope the new Cardassian will have more people on him. This morning I went to the Tarlac Sector and attended the memorial service for Legate Damar and the dedication of a simple marker to his memory. You know, when Commander Kira and I were first assigned to work with Damar's resistance, if I had every intention of killing him at the first opportunity in revenge for his murder of Seattle. But as we worked together, I understood that he was a true product of Cardassian militarism and devoutly believed in his duty. When Xiao betrayed her father, Ducat, and chose to remain on the station, Damar saw that his superior officer was becoming unhinged and believed that it was his duty to kill her. But Garrett, you'll say, there's no excuse for killing a defenseless woman, and there isn't. Unless you've been brought up in our system. I also came to admire Damar's idealism and his decision to renounce his allegiance to the Dominion. If he had one weakness, it was his propensity for long winded speeches. But given the fact that none of us are perfect, the man would have made a fine leader. As I stood at the memorial service, I thought about the grand affairs I witnessed here when I was a boy. I mean, none of our famed heroes and statesmen ever had such a humble service. And none of them, from Tret a Clean On, deserved more than Korat Damar. I also thought about this Cardassian sense of duty and how he is largely responsible for bringing those of us who are left these current circumstances. I asked Dr. Carmack how an entire people can come under the sway of this duty and blindly give allegiance to a state that goes mad and murders its own children. Poisonous pedagogy, he replied. We believe what we are taught. Chapter 4. Entry. The Bamard Institute is located in the highlands adjacent to the Mekar Wilderness, a hot and arid area with sublimely beautiful rock formations and an endless network of subterranean caverns. At first, the landscape was foreign, even threatening to my city mind and body. These seemingly endless skies and empty vistas, empty of man-made incursion, made me anxious. The Institute itself also made me anxious. Every waking moment was planned and accounted for. The Cardassian educational system is dedicated to the ideal that each generation needs a coterie of leadership, an elite in every segment of society. Artists, soldiers, politicians, scholars, business and tradespeople all have appropriate institutes where they are sent at the age of emergence. At that point, he or she is identified and assigned to live and study apart from family at home for 9 years. The course of study is divided into 3 progressive levels, and every 3 years, one either advances from one level to the next or returns to serve society in a necessary but more humble position. If a person makes it through and completes the 3rd level, he or she is then placed in the ruling vanguard of that segment. My first day set the tone for my new life. After the orientation for the incoming students, at which the first prefect, the head of the Institute, likened us to the missing pieces of the mosaic of Cardassian civilization, the adults handed us over to the upper-level students, who promptly separated us according to gender, stripped us of all personal possessions, gave us our scratchy drab uniforms, swamped green and black. Is it any wonder I ended up as a tailor? And assigned us to living quarters that consisted consisted of 10 narrow beds and an adjoining tiled room for our hygiene. For the next 3 years, with the exception of our instructional docents, we rarely came into contact with adults. My childhood was indeed old. I was assigned to the Lubach group, level 1, and my numerical designation was number 10. From that moment, I was no longer Elam Garrett, but 10 Lubach, and we were sternly warned never to refer to ourselves or to each other by anything other than our number group designation. We were the missing pieces. And in order to find our place in the mosaic of civilized society, we had to be broken down and reconstructed from the bottom up. 10 Lubach! And the person to begin this restructuring process was our section leader, one Tarnal, a physically powerful third-level individual with a thick neck and closely set eyes. Yes? Yes, section leader. I was instructed to go to the stockroom and bring back implements to clean the hygiene chamber. After he gave me directions, he told me that I could take as many of my section mates as I wished to accompany me. I was somewhat confused by the offer, but I thought it was a test of my self-reliance and replied that I could handle the errand by myself. Then go! Yes, section leader. And after wandering through what seemed like a labyrinthine maze in which I saw other new students on similar errands, I finally found the stop. The door opened. And the students my age came stumbling out with cleaning equipment and looking very untidy. He gave me a quick, fearful glance before he disappeared down the corridor. He should be punished for his appearance, I thought. Next, a distinctive and gruff voice shouted from within. I entered and was surprised by the enveloping darkness. Hello? I hesitated, afraid of stumbling into something. Did you come alone? The gruff voice asked. Yes, I came for, before I could finish, a hand grabbed me by the hair, and the lights went on. Facing me were 3 older students, perhaps level 2. Why didn't you come alone? The gruff voice was behind me, along with the owner of the hand that held my head facing front. When I tried to turn, the hand painfully tightened its grip. I thought that you thought only of yourself. You didn't think of the group. From now on, you're going to learn never to think of yourself apart from the group. At which point I was punched and kicked several times. I tried to resist, to fight back, but there were too many of them. I went down on my knees, trying to catch the breath that was knocked out of me. I was clearly overpowered, but I refused to cry, and I refused to concede defeat. I would die before I did either. Enough! The gruff voice called out. One of my attackers pulled me up, and another handed me 2 buckets filled with cleaning solutions and implements. Take them and go back to your section. And remember, 10 Lubach, this is what happens when you separate from your group. All individuals are hunted and punished. By yourself, you're pudding. We're going to be watching you. I was pushed toward the door, and the lights went out. The door opened, and as I stumbled through with the buckets, I nearly bumped into another student who was waiting to go in. We looked at each other, and I recognized the disapproval on his face. I thought of warning him, but something told me to return to my section. I hurried past him and heard the gruff voice call out, "Next!" Chapter 5. End.
Tell me, Mr. Garrett,
Captain Sisko said as he intently studied the use of the diagram in the Cardassian unit.
Oh, what do you think? Cardassian defense perimeter is most important.
I know. How do you explain an alien? That's the one place where Cardassians are not vulnerable. The good captain gave me one of his bemused glances and stared through. The likelihood of any exploited weakness, I replied, would be in the chain of command between the Founder's orders and the execution of these orders by the Porter and their drug-addicted Jem'Hadar soldiers. If it's a perimeter put in place by the Cardassians, it won't be vulnerable. The captain gave me a skeptical look.
That's a very confident assessment.
Captain, Cardassians come into this life with an awareness of their protective perimeters, what the doctor calls our reptilian brain dominance, and die defending them. The captain nodded, turned back to the diagram. I almost added that in between we perfect this awareness of faces that we're allowing to work. Chapter 6. Males and females of the first and second levels were kept separate at the mine. While we shared certain docents and outside training areas, each group had its own living quarters and facilities. It was explained to us that until we became disciplined in our relations with the complementary gender, we would make better progress. When I asked one Tarna how we would learn this discipline if there was no interaction between the sexes, he blinked and mumbled something about distractions. When I asked what this meant, I was told that I had a loose mouth and was given 5 days of hygiene chamber maintenance as punishment. You don't know enough to ask so many questions. I started asking how I could learn, how I could learn without asking questions, when he pulled out his murking stick, so named because they are used to beat murks, which is what first level students are called, and gave me a whack on the leg and told me to get to the storeroom for cleaning up. When the pain passed through me, I looked around for group support. You can be sure that this time I wanted to be accompanied by as many of my mates as possible. There were 5 students in the room, and when I made my request, 4 of them had excuses ranging from barely plausible to outright suspicious. 3 Lubach, the biggest in our section, and the one I most wanted to go with me, said, "The section leader is right, you talk too much." Unfortunately, the only student left was the quiet 8 Lubach, who kept completely to himself. He agreed to accompany me and quickly moved to the door. He was short and slender, and his dark eyes and long lashes made him look younger than the rest of us. He was almost too delicate for a Cardassian. I was not encouraged, but I had no choice. I went through the door, unconsciously imitating the gruff voice from my previous experience. "All right, all I need is an extra pair of eyes. Just keep them open and let's get the job done." Abe said nothing. The trip to the storeroom was uneventful, and we received our supplies without incident. On the way back, however, we noticed that an intersection of 2 corridors was much darker than before. 8, who was walking behind, touched my shoulder. "Ah, I think we forgot something," he said with uncharacteristic loudness. He motioned for me to follow. We backtracked to the previous intersection, made a right turn, and continued down another corridor until we came to a 3rd intersection. He stopped, took the cleaning implements from me, and carefully put them down. He chose one that was attached to the pole and handed it to me. He took a shorter implement, looked around the corner, down the darkened corridor, and quickly moved to the other side. I started to follow him, but he made it clear that I should stay where I was and wait. Alternate this, it was quiet and controlled, and as sure of himself as if he'd done this many times. How did he know where he was going? How did he... When he heard his footsteps coming down the corridor from the direction 8 had anticipated, he held up 2 fingers indicating how many people. We kept out of sight from either side of the corridor as they approached. His face was dark, intense with concentration. His brow ridges, unusually pronounced, cast shadows over his eyes. My heart began to pound when I realized what 8 was planning. These were older students. Certainly, but he expressed no hesitation, no doubt. Just as the 2 unsuspecting students passed, the one closest to me caught sight of me, but it was too late. We were on them, and we both knew exactly what to do. First, we disarmed them of their murking sticks with blows to their hands and arms. Then we laid into them with such ferocity that they fled down the corridor. "I'll show you who's pudding," I started to follow. "No!" Again, the strength of his voice shocked me. I stopped, and before I could ask why, we heard a high-pitched whistle screech out the emergency signal for immediate assistance that we had just learned in a field training class. We grabbed our implements and ran as fast as we could all the way back to our section. We burst through the door, flushed out of breath. Most of the group was present and wanted to know what had happened. In my excitement, I started to tell the story when 8 dropped a pail with implements and grabbed my attention. He looked shocked. What? I stammered. I followed his nod to the door where one Tarnak was giving me a hard look. 8 moved to his sleeping area and quietly busied himself in his private room. I immediately shut up under the influence and took them into a hygiene chamber. Shortly after we were alone, I asked. and punched a code. I was about to comment on his rudeness when he turned back and handed it to me. It was a diagram of the rooms and corridors on the storeroom floor. We'd all been given schematics of the Bomarian spaces. I assumed no one paid any attention. I don't know. I didn't know then if I could ever call Abe a friend. Something about him was strange and impenetrable. But it didn't matter. At least I knew there was one person in my section I could trust. How I had misjudged him. It was obvious that Abe had what Cardassians call a ferocious spirit, and that I could learn a great deal from him. Can you take a couple more pages? No, I don't want to beat you guys up, you know. And also, a couple more pages, is your case. You can hear my voice. I'm going south, but it's okay. Much of the focus of Cardassian education, especially during the early years, is exhausting and merciless physical training. The training area on Deep Space Nine always amused me. People struggling by themselves with weights and machines in front of a mirror. The results seem more about strengthening the appearance of the body rather than the fiber of the character. Our training centers on the trial of one person's skill matched against the skill of another. But where Klingons regard physical combat as the primary test of mastery, we begin at that level and then progress to the subtler methods of confrontation. There are enough levels of expertise for two lifetimes, but a student has to master each one before moving on to the next. It was during these trials that we came to truly know each other. We assembled in the burning sands of the pit, where each day we had long eye, hand, and foot sessions. The pit was the most feared training area at Bomarin. It truly took the measure of each student. These initial sessions were the fundamental underpinnings of all subsequent training. Basically, the concept was to teach the hands, the eyes, and the feet to operate independently in order to function in countless combinations called stratagems controlled by the brain. The stratagems ranged from simple fight combinations of kicks and punches to complicated dances that resembled religious trance. Calix, our martial docent, was a gnarled old man with one glass eye. It was rumored that he was an infantry god who was demoted because he refused the privilege of executive status and put himself in danger with his men. It was after his demotion that he dedicated himself to mastering stratagems. Of course, we called him Calix behind his back, since that was the name of the whirling, muscular beast of many appendages from our childhood stories. Like the fabled Calix, our docent was capable of blinding displays of fighting prowess, and yet at rest, he was as remarkable as a rock. On the first day in the pit, we stood in formation for what seemed like hours while he simply stared at us. I was drenched in my fluids, nauseated by the baking sun. Six Lubach fainted, and when five made a move to tend to him, Calix spit in his face. As with humans, this is a humiliating, demeaning gesture. We were stunned. Step forward, his voice was jarring and gentle, the half smile replaced the blank mask. Five just stared at him, spit dripping from his face with sweat. He behaved as if the docent had spoken in an alien tongue and mixed signals and confused us all. Stand in front of me, Calix. Five was compact, and his trained athletic body moved carefully. Anticipation of a trick. He stopped in front of Calix, whose half smile revealed both missing teeth. I want you to get me off of my place without losing yours, Calix explained. Five seemed transfixed by the half smile. I wasn't sure he understood the request. I wasn't sure I understood. We remained in formation while they stood facing each other. This standoff lasted forever. Five wavered, but he held his position, never taking his eyes off Calix. My entire body was now screaming in pain. The pit was in the far corner, away from the other training areas. Each was cut off by a barrier, so you really couldn't see what was going on in adjoining areas. Voices and sounds would drift in and out of awareness. My mind wandered. I was sure that I'd heard the sounds of the women students gusting with the wind. Suddenly, my mother materialized. She looked like she was apologizing. I wanted to tell her how much I missed her. Your image dissolved. Father took her place. I knew he was telling me something very important, but I was growing dizzy and I was afraid that I'd join six on the ground. His words were carried away by the winds. Father faded, and gradually I became aware of a figure entering from the right side of my peripheral vision. He was dressed in student black and green, moving slowly. No! She was dressed in the classic long Cardassian skirts. This is against the rules. What's she doing here? She glided into full view and stood right between Calix and Five Pop. The dry Makar winds billowed her skirts and whipped her purple-black hair, obscuring her face. Did anyone else see her? I wanted to look around to have my vision corroborated, but I couldn't take my eyes off her. She stopped, returned my look. Her hair whipped behind her, exposing her unguarded eyes. She said something, but again I couldn't hear the words. I moved to her. She was radiant. I was drawn to her. Everything else fell into shadow as if I were moving through a tunnel.
Where are you going, Tan? You're losing your place.
It was the gruff voice from the storeroom. My female vision reacted to the voice and looked in the direction from where it came. I followed her look, and just as I began to discern the outline of another person, tall, graceful, the emerging negative of a picture, I experienced an icy, painful spasm that pulled me back to the pit. It was as if my heart had been crushed in a strong grip. I staggered and nearly fell.
You look lost, Ted.
I turned to the voice, which now was familiar and no longer gruff. It was Calix, and I was standing in front of him. What happened to Five? I wanted to look. I wanted to look for the young woman, the gruff voice, but I didn't dare take my eyes away from Calix.
Did you see them?
Or hear them? He asked. I hesitated. How he knew?
Both, I replied. Did you recognize them?
My parents. Not the other two. Someone behind me started to laugh, but Calix stopped him.
The other two. Is that when you lost your place?
I nodded. His questions were softly asked, almost kindly. I don't know why I wasn't surprised that he knew. Instead, I was grateful. It told me I wasn't going mad.
You have your work cut out, Tan.
I nodded again as if some part of me understood what he meant.
Are you up to this? Can you learn to hold your place?
I just stared back at him, not knowing how to respond. Softly, he blew two angry breaths into my eyes, and blindly I stumbled back.
Can you even find a place to hold? He asked.
I came back to my sweating body and felt totally exhausted and beat. We were dismissed, and I watched everyone move away. I had no idea what had just happened to me. My work was cut out, Caleb told me. I had to find my place and hold it. But how do I even begin? Thank you.
right to the very end of things, you know? So I hope you all go out and you